Okay, so good morning to one and all. Okay, to gather here for this today YouTube session on bacterial pigments. Okay, so the bacterial pigments will be one of the important virulent mechanism for the bacterial agent. At the same time, the pigments can be used for demonstration of the microbial agent once we are doing in a culture. Okay, so bacteria will have a various virulent mechanism. And remember, the bacteria will have a various virulent mechanism. Among the virulent mechanism, the pigments will be one of the important one, as well as we can demonstrate effectively during our culture. So once the culture will be taken for demonstrating the pigment, we are using mainly a solid culture medium for demonstration purpose. Okay, so solid media will be very effective media for demonstrating the bacterial pigments, okay, during the culture for diagnostic purpose. Okay, so coming to the bacterial virulent mechanism, yes, bacterial virulence, it may be due to toxins or it may be due to enzymes, or it may be due to pigments, okay, or due to any secreting proteins, okay, or any secreting toxins like bacteriocins. Okay, so there is a lot of virulent mechanism which is released from the bacteria during the active metabolism. So starting from the toxins, enzymes, pigments, proteins and bacteriocins. So now among this, what about one classical point to be remembered for the pigments? That means the bacteria is releasing the pigment at the tissue level for a virulent mechanism. Okay, if the same pigment will be demonstrable during the isolation in a culture media, is taken for identification. So now what is the point to be remembered here? Whatever the pigment which is released from the bacterium at the tissue level as a virulent mechanism, yes, the same can be demonstrated in the culture media for identification. Okay, right. So, but coming to the toxins or enzymes or the other virulent mechanism, we cannot demonstrate all the virulent mechanism which is present in the tissue level responsible for the virulence, we cannot demonstrate in a culture media. Okay, right. So, for example, toxins. Bacteria will be responsible for two type of toxins. One is called as exotoxin. The second one is called as endotoxin. Okay, so the exotoxin, either from Staph aureus, either from Clostridium, either from Bacillus, okay, but we cannot able to demonstrate all the toxin by the culture medium. So we can demonstrate only some few toxin by culture methods, but not all. Similarly, endotoxin can be demonstrated by the ELISA based method, but not mainly in a culture medium. So the two, not all the endotoxin as well as not all the exotoxin. Similarly, enzymes. So some of the enzymes we can demonstrate in culture. For example, catalase we can demonstrate. Coagulase we can demonstrate. Phosphatase we can demonstrate. Lecithinase we can demonstrate. But we cannot demonstrate the other, the enzymes that, for example, hyaluronidase, streptokinase, streptodornase, okay, these are all the some of the enzymes we cannot demonstrate in a culture medium. Similarly, the secreting proteins and the bacteriocins also will be effectively present at the tissue level, but we may not be able to demonstrate effectively in the culture medium. Okay, so that is the one important point to be remembered regarding the pigments. So pigments will have some advantage compared to other virulent mechanism during the diagnostic procedure. Okay, so now we are going to discuss the pigment from the bacterial agent. one by one. Okay, so first we can start with Staphylococcus. Okay, so Staphylococcus is the genus, okay, that will be having the various species. Okay, what are the examples of Staphylococcal species? So Staph, aureus, Staph, albus, Staph, citrus. So now from the name itself we can able to find out or understand, so some color impact will be used for making the species level. You can see aureus, AU, AU is the symbol of gold. So Staph aureus is the Staphylococcal species, will be capable of golden yellow pigment. So we can give the name for the species will be Staph aureus. Then coming to albus, as we know albus means it is white. So white pigment from Staphylococcal albus, so we give the name for the species depends on the white pigment. Then coming to the citrus, that is lemon yellow pigment. Okay, lemon yellow pigment, so we called as Staphylococcal citrus. Okay, so now though we are giving the name for the Staphylococcal species depends on their pigmentary nature, either golden yellow, white or the lemon yellow pigment. Among this, not all the species are responsible for the disease in human always. So Staph aureus will be taken as a strict pathogen. But albus and the citrus is taken as commensals. Okay, so the albus and citrus is not responsible for the disease in a normal individual with a good immunity, because they are commensals, they are using as a defense mechanism, not allowing the other microbial agent to make the disease. So commensals are nothing but a normal flora. Okay, right. Now the Staphylococcal albus and Staphylococcal citrus will be given with a name of the pigments. So they are comes under the commensal. Commensal means it will be present in some a specific site in the human. So we are just renaming them depends on their commensal site. So albus will be renamed because it is present in the skin into epidermidis. Okay, so citrus will be present in the genital epithelial cell, so we can rename to saprophyticus. Okay, but the Staph aureus will be retained with the name, okay, because it is not having any commensal role, that is a strict pathogenic role. Okay, now coming to the examples to define here, yes. So if you are allowing the organism to grow, yes, we can demonstrate Staph aureus, a golden yellow pigment. Okay, yes. So the name of the culture methodology is called as a streak culture. So what do you mean by streak culture? So we are streaking or inoculating the sample in the surface of the solid medium, okay, in a streak manner, we call it as a streak culture. So it will produces a golden yellow pigment. Okay, yes, now you can see. So each and every streaking we can able to demonstrate the growth as well as the pigment to be remembered. Okay, so the pigmentation in the Staphylococcus aureus will be a golden yellow pigment. Okay, now coming to the other Staphylococcal species, okay, the second one is Staphylococcus albus. Okay, albus means it produces a white pigment. Then coming to the Staphylococcal citrus, a Staphylococcal citrus will produce a lemon yellow pigment. Okay, so we are demonstrating the three different pigment from the Staphylococcal group. One is aureus with a golden yellow pigment, albus with a white pigment, and citrus with a lemon yellow pigment. Okay, so this is the pigmentation from staphylococcal genus into the species. All the three will be having some specific pigmentary nature. So albus and citrus are commensal. Okay, that is not normally responsible for the disease in human. So we can just rename the albus and citrus. It depends on the commensal site to remember, either epidermidis and saprophyticus respectively. Okay, aureus will be a strict pathogen, albus and citrus will be the commensals. Okay, so now once we are demonstrating the pigment in the culture medium, so we have to apply one specific point for the understanding. Okay, if the pigment will be released from the bacterium, it is present in the surface of the bacterium or the colony. Okay, accepted. At the same time, the pigment is not released out of the bacterium into the media. That means the pigment is not allowing or not readily present in the medium, because the medium is a hydrated medium. If the pigment will be having the character of water soluble, readily it will be released from the bacterial surface into the medium. That means the medium also will hold in the same color like bacterial agent. So now this property will be taken for a differentiating feature. So if the bacterium will be releasing the pigment, which is a water soluble property, it is not only demonstrable in the surface of the colony, and also the medium will be receiving the pigment or color. Okay, now these type of pigments are called as water soluble pigment or diffusible pigment, because that will be diffuses from the bacterium into the media. What is the reason for this diffusion? Is water soluble nature. Okay, so now any pigment if you are demonstrating in the culture, first point we have to remember, what about the color? The second one, either it is present only in the surface of the colony or it is also will be released into the medium. So we have to assess, because that can be used for differentiating the bacterial pigment, either it is a diffusible pigment or non-diffusible pigment, or otherwise called as water soluble and water insoluble pigment. Okay, there is a two different type of pigment from the bacterial agent to be remembered. Okay, right, accepted. So now what about the answer here? Yes, we are getting only in the surface of the colonies, not into the medium. That means it is non-diffusible pigment. Okay, so here we are getting the color only in the colony surface, the medium is not getting any color. That means the pigment is not the character of water solubility, so the media is not receiving, because it won't dissolve in the water. Okay, so all the three staphylococcal pigments are non-diffusible. Okay, right, accepted. Now coming to the second group of the pigmentary bacterium is atypical mycobacterium. Yes, atypical mycobacterium. So this atypical mycobacterium, which is responsible for the disease in human, okay, so similar to the mycobacterium tuberculosis, that will be causing the disease, but not that much common to be remembered. Yes, now this atypical mycobacterium will be grown in which medium? Yes, the media which is common for mycobacterium is Lowenstein-Jensen medium. Yes, Lowenstein-Jensen medium. This Lowenstein-Jensen medium, we are inoculating the sample. Okay, and it will take 4 weeks to 6 weeks for the growth. Yes, after the 4 weeks to 6 weeks, the organism will be growing. Okay, we can demonstrate the growth along with pigments in the case of atypical mycobacterium. Okay, so we discussed already in the mycobacterial chapter the atypical mycobacterium will be classified depends on the pigmentary nature. We call it as photochromogen and scotochromogen. Photochromogen means we have to keep the LJ bottles will be light exposed, it produces the pigment. Sometimes even we are not exposing to the light, still the some of the atypical mycobacterium is capable of making a pigment, we call it as a scotochromogen. So photochromogens producing the color after exposed to the light. Scotochromogen even not exposing to the light, that produces a pigment or the color in the culture medium. Okay, now either photochromogen or scotochromogen, what about the color we are demonstrating in the LJ medium, that is yellow color. So yellow pigmentary nature or the yellow pigmentary growth will be easily demonstrated in the LJ medium, okay, for a specific identification. So Mycobacterium tuberculosis will be growing, that may not have any pigmentary nature, that will be only a slightly a glistening, the rough colonies are there, but the classical yellow pigment will be demonstrated either Mycobacterium gansasi or Mycobacterium gardone, because they are comes under the photochromogen and scotochromogen, that will definitely will make the color to remember. So what about the color will be demonstrated, that is yellow color to be demonstrated. So any pigmentary nature, what is the point we discuss already, we have to say either it is a diffusible or non-diffusible pigment. You can see the colonies will be holding the yellow color but not into the medium, it is called as non-diffusible pigment. Okay, so MTB is not having any pigment at all, that will be one advantage of differentiating MTB from atypical. So we are inoculating the sample into the LJ medium, we are waiting for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and slowly the organism will start growing. During the growth we are not getting any color that will be taken for MTB. Once it is making the yellow color, that will be mainly think of atypical mycobacterium. Okay, so the atypical will be demonstrated mainly by their yellow pigmentary nature, it is also comes under non-diffusible pigment to remember. Okay, so what is the medium for growing mycobacterial group, that is Lowenstein Jensen medium. Okay, right. Now coming to the third example of a pigmentary bacterium is Nocardia. So Nocardia is responsible for which clinical symptom in human? This is the cause of bacterial mycetoma, because mycetoma is due to the two groups of bacteria, one is Nocardia, the second one will be actinomycetes. Okay, the second one will be actinomycetes. There is a two bacterial agent will be responsible for the bacterial mycetoma. Among this, the common bacterium will be Nocardia. So once if you are suspecting the mycetoma or the subcutaneous lesion, we are taking a sample and we are inoculating into the culture. In the culture we are getting yellow to orange pigment will be therefore demonstrating Nocardia. Okay, so yellow to orange pigment will be very classical for Nocardia. Then moreover, the colony morphology itself will be very very classical, so that will be not smooth, that will be a rough colonies. Okay, that will be a rough colonies will having yellow to orange pigment. The colonies are so like in a groups or in a what to say, that is in a lined manner. Okay, it is like a continuous a lined manner it will be present. Okay, so the growth will be effectively demonstrated in a solid medium. We can demonstrate yellow to orange pigment is very classical for nocardia to be diagnosed. Okay, so the aerobic mycetoma or bacterial mycetoma is mainly by the bacterium called as nocardia. We can able to demonstrate by culture. Okay, so from the culture we can do the staining procedure for confirmation. Now the pigment itself will be taken for a confirmation in the case of nocardia as a bacterial mycetoma agent. Okay, right. Now coming to the next group of bacterium is Serratia morsescens. Okay, Serratia morsescens. So it produces a morsescent pigment. The morsescent pigment will be otherwise called as prodigiosin pigment. Prodigiosin, okay, it is nothing but a red color pigment. So red pigment will be called as prodigiosin or morsescin. Okay, so Serratia will be a gram negative bacterium responsible for invasive manifestation like the wound infection, urinary tract infection, especially for lung infection if the patient is hospitalized and also the patient is on ventilator. The organism may colonizes in the endotracheal tube responsible for ventilator associated pneumonia or hospital acquired pneumonia. Okay, yes, so this will be mainly responsible for pneumonia. So once we are collecting the sputum sample either by the aspirate or if the patient will be giving the sputum, okay, during the pneumonic individual, so we are inoculating into the culture, we are getting the growth of Serratia. So the Serratia will be effectively grown in a solid culture medium. It will be start growing a pinkish red color. Okay, if we are extending the incubation, so this is 24 hours, this is 36 to 40 days. So if we are extending the incubation slightly further, it will be turned into a complete red. Okay, so the intensity of the color will be increased from the pinkish red to the red, dark red color. It is by just extending the incubation time for Serratia. So now this condition may be misleading our diagnosis. Okay, because normally the person will be getting the infection of any of the alveolar infection or the lung infection. Once it is making the capillary rupture, so now the person will be having the sputum with RBC. So that will give a red color sputum, we called as hemoptysis. Okay, now in the case of Serratia, the person will be inoculating or infecting with the Serratia in the lungs. The growth also will be there in the lungs along with the sputum we are collecting. So the sputum will be holding the growth of Serratia as well as their pigment. So now this will appear as a RBC or the red color in the sputum. Once we are exposing or demonstrating in the microscopy, we cannot able to find any RBCs. But what is the reason for this red color? Yes, it is due to the prodigiosin or the red pigment. So normally the red color sputum, we always say it is a hemoptysis, RBCs. But here the red color is due to the pigment from the bacterium, not by the RBCs. So this condition will be described as pseudo hemoptysis. It's called as pseudo hemoptysis. Okay, so the red color sputum is mainly due to, yes, the pigment from the bacterium, not by the RBCs. Okay, so here you can see pigment will be present only in the bacterial surface. Again, it's not into the medium. Again, we called as non-diffusible pigment. Okay, right. Now, coming to the next bacterium is Chromobacterium violaceum. Yes, now you can see the word chromo means color. Bacterium, microbial agent. Yes, violaceum, it produces violet or lavender. Okay, so the color producing the bacteria, that is violet or the lavender, so we called as Chromobacter violaceum or Chromobacterium violaceum. Okay, so this bacterium will be comes under the gram-negative bacterium. Though it is a rare mechanism to make the disease, once the person is developing the infection, that will be very severe, and as well as we have to give an adequate and a proper treatment for this bacterium. Okay, so the virulence as well as the infectivity is very high for this Chromobacter violaceum. So we have to start the antibiotic at the earliest after a proper diagnosis in the culture by having lavender or the violet pigment. So Chromobacter violaceum responsible for violet or the lavender pigment. So here also you can see the colony surface will be having the color, but not in the medium. It is also taken as non-diffusible pigment. Okay, yes. So this also called as a streak culture. We can gradually reduce the bacterial colonies, and finally we are getting the individual colonies for a specific identification. This is a streak culture. Okay, so the lavender or the violet pigment demonstrated in the culture will be diagnostic of Chromobacterium violaceum. Okay, now coming to the last component, but is well known component, is Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It is a gram negative bacterium responsible for a invasive manifestation. Okay, highly virulent, highly drug resistant. Okay, and the survival will be very important for the Pseudomonas, because it may not be destroyed or inhibited by the routine disinfectant chemicals. So normally we are using the disinfectant chemical for the mopping or the cleaning purpose, but Pseudomonas can able to grow even in the presence of disinfectant solution. So the survival is very important for the disease purpose. So it cannot be destroyed effectively by most of the disinfection. Then one more interesting point to be remember: one disinfectant solution, instead of inhibiting or blocking the growth of pseudo, that will allow the enhancement of the Pseudomonas. Okay, so which will be having the enhancement growth of Pseudomonas? By cetrimide. Okay, by cetrimide. So cetrimide will be the one of the important disinfectant solution. So that will be taken by the Pseudomonas as a effective a growth enhancer. Okay, so that's why normally most of the bacterial agent will be inhibited based on the exposure with the chemical and antibiotics. But Pseudomonas will be not responding to the normal group of antibiotic. Okay, and as well as it will be growing in the presence of a disinfectant solutions. So each and every group of antibiotic, so we have in the last lines will be anti-pseudomonal groups. For example, you take penicillin, there will be anti-pseudomonal penicillins. If you are taking the cephalosporins, we have anti-pseudomonal cephalosporins. So that's why each and every group will have a specific group of drugs will be used for a control of Pseudomonas aeruginosa. So that's why the bacterium will be very important for the disease, because of prevention or control is not possible by disinfection. The treatment also is not effective by the therapy because of it is drug resistance. Okay, Pseudomonas is responsible for a four different pigment. One is pyocyanin, then pyoverdin, then pyomelanin, and pyorubin. Okay, you can see pyocyanin, it is a bluish green pigment. Pyoverdin is a fluorescent pigment. pyomelanin is a brownish, pyorubin is red pigment. Okay, so pyocyanin and pyoverdin, because of the fluorescence we can easily demonstrate, but there is a slight confusion between melanin and rubin, because the brown and red color may not be easily differentiated in the culture. So, but the melanin and rubin will be the darker and melanin will be a somewhat a lighter one. Okay, so now what about one important point to be remember here? Yes, the bacterial colonies will have a color. What happened to the medium? Yes, medium also is receiving the color from the bacterium. That means the pigment will be capable of dissolving in water. We call it as water soluble nature. So water soluble nature will be taken for effective demonstration of a pseudomonal pigment, that is Pseudomonas aeruginosa. It have four different pigment. We can easily demonstrate by a diffusible nature or water soluble property. Okay, because of this water soluble property, we can able to differentiate the pseudomonal pigment from the other pigment. Moreover, the color will be present in Pseudomonas may not be there in the other bacterial agent. Even the serratia will have a very very dark red in color, that will be confined to the bacterium, not released into the medium. Okay, so now the bacterial pigment from the Pseudomonas will be taken for effective diagnosis, and also we can differentiate from the other because of it is diffusible pigment. So among the listed bacterial pigments, only one will be taken as a diffusible, that is Pseudomonas. Then all the other pigments are non-diffusible in nature, either staphylococci or serratia, chromobacter violaceum, atypical mycobacterium or nocardia. So all the pigments are, yes, it is a non-diffusible in nature. Now coming to the applications of the bacterial pigment, as you can see, chromobacter will releases violaceum. So violaceum will be used as an anti-tumor, antimicrobial and anti-parasitic and also antifungal effect. Okay, so here antimicrobial means the pigment will inhibit the function of the drug what we are giving. Okay, that is antifungal effect. So the chromobacterium violaceum is used for preparing the antifungal property or antifungal agent preparation. Then coming to the Pseudomonas, it is antimicrobial agent, that is not having any effect over the antimicrobe, that is drugs may not going to convert, that is inhibit the pyocyanin, to remember. Okay, yes, so now the bacterial pigments are important for diagnostic purpose and identification. We can differentiate by diffusible or non-diffusible depends on water soluble property or water insoluble property. So the pigment will be effectively used for diagnostic purpose. So if the bacterium is releasing the pigment at the tissue level, the same can be demonstrable in culture for specific identification. Okay, right. Now with that we are concluding the today's session. Okay, so I hope this will be useful for you for your entrance preparation. Okay, you can join an academy for more classes and more batches. So we are delivering more lectures for the benefit of the students to crack the forthcoming exams. Okay, so until then, bye from Dr. Vasant. You can use my code for joining DRVP-UT for more classes in an academy. Thank you. Bye bye. See you. கண்ணா வந்துட்டியம்மா சொல்லுமா.